We've been joined by a former World Cup winning rugby player and now TV presenter Melody Robinson. Our day started in Northland's Whangaroa Harbour, where we set off aboard the Ultimate Lady. And this trip was going to be more than just fishing. Our aim was to catch a striped marlin off the Bay of Islands coast and release it with satellite tags. And while it's a pretty cool job to be lumbered with, what we hoped to do could provide some crucial scientific data on New Zealand's striped marlin biomass.
Pleasant morning swim. Your scallops should go down well for lunch. Now, of course, the best way to eat seafood is straight out of the ocean. And while scallops are great cooked, they're fantastic to have raw. So, as soon as I get out of the water, I like to see how fat they are. That meat is so sweet. I call it seafood ice cream, the old scallops. And we better give you a sample. Their mouth, I can see your mouth watering away.
Yeah.
There you go. A la naturel.
Wicked.
Get into that.
Oh, yum.
Our main job as part of the satellite tagging team was to gather and prepare lunch and wind in a marlin once we hooked up. Meanwhile, the team of scientists that were conducting the tagging program were busy analysing data from previous satellite tags and preparing the tags and transmitters that we hoped to deploy on a healthy striped marlin. But my work for the morning wasn't over yet. The team wanted more seafood for lunch and I was more than happy to oblige. So in I went for another dive. With crayfish to go with our scallops, we headed off to the warm blue water where we found huge schools of skipjack tuna. Marlin love to eat these tasty little tuna, and we were certain a marlin wouldn't be too far away.
He's on the right there. Oh, nice bite.
Oh, drop them.
Unfortunately, the hookup was short-lived, but oh well, I guess we'd have to keep hard at it trying to catch another one. All the satellite tagging work and marlin research had made us hungry, so it was time for lunch.
Now welcome to what is the second, and I promise the last, installment of Matt's Kitchen. And what we've got here is a crayfish that I've plucked out of the water this morning, and we're always looking for new things we can do with our crayfish rather than just boil them up, because we're sport for them up here in Northland. And what I've done is while the crayfish is still raw, I've just chopped the tail off and I'm going to chuck it into a little bit of boiling water. I've only got a tiny little bit of water in there. I'm not actually trying to cook it. I'm just going to steam it for maybe 20 or 30 seconds and that's going to loosen the flesh around the shell so we can pull the flesh out of the shell while it's still raw. And while I'm gassing, that's probably about enough now. So that's not cooked yet. Still raw. Take a decent pair of scissors and cut right up the middle of the shell, and it's kind of quite jelly like this meat you can see in there. Okay, and that meat should just peel away from the shell, and it's not cooked yet, remember, it's raw. So we're left with this nice long bit of raw crayfish tail meat. I'm just going to chop that up into bite-sized pieces just like so, and I've got here a bag with a few breadcrumbs in it, some pepper and salt, because whenever I'm cooking any sort of seafood, I don't like to overdo it with the flavouring or herbs and spices. When you eat seafood, you want to be able to taste the seafood. Just chuck those bits in there, give them a shake around, and that gives us some crumbed crayfish tail. And that there, that little bit of crumbed crayfish tail is ready to go straight onto the barbecue. You don't have to have a barbecue, a hot pan with some oil in it will do the trick. And these are just going to fry away in a bit of olive oil. And of course, let's not forget about the other half of the crayfish, the best part, the old body we've still got there. There's plenty of meat in the legs and in the gearbox. And we've still got our little bit of water in there. And we're just going to boil that like we normally would. Leave the cray body in there for 7 or 8 minutes. And that's plenty of time for us to cook up these crumbed crayfish tail pieces. For lunch, we've also chucked a few steaks on the barbecue. I've got the scallops we got this morning as well. And all I've done with these is thrown in a dollop of butter, cut up a couple of cloves of garlic. I'm just gonna throw them on top. And they call it reef and beef, a steak with some scallops on top. I like to call it a steak with scallops on top. We'll have that, a bit of our crayfish tail and crayfish body with a bit of salad, and that'll be our lunch. Here's our steak. It goes on the old plate with a bit of salad. This is the special magical part, is the old scallies on top.
Surf and turf.
Yep, that's the one. A couple of bits of cray tail. And these cooking segments always look better when you've got a pretty girl, so you've done your bit.
I've cooked up. You're the perfect man, you can cook.
Hear that? The perfect man. I like that. I'll keep you on.
With lunch out of the way, it was back to work trying to catch a marlin. And right on cue, not one but two marlin showed up. One of them ate a lure, and Mel was in the chair, hooked up to her first ever marlin.
Oh, nice fish.
Hard as you can, that's it. Keep going, hard as you can, keep going. Fish is kind of digging in down deep. Have a breather.
You having fun?
You know what it's all cracked up about now?
Yeah.
When Mel came along, I'm sure she thought it would be more like lounging around on a deck lounger.
Yeah.
Being served freshly cooked seafood, which it was, until mayhem broke out when two marlin came up and struck. We've got one hooked up. Mel's in the chair, her first day's game fishing, and she's hooked a marlin, which to a lot of people that have been trying for 10 years, would love to be in that seat, Mel, so you owe it to everyone out there.
Oh, yeah.
Here's our dedicated team of scientists, and we've got this ramp set up here. It's been custom built for the boat. When the fish comes up, the door's going to come open, the ramp's going to slide into the water. We're actually going to bring this fish, slide it up on board. We've got all our tools ready to go here, and I'm really looking forward to seeing this team at work, getting these satellite tags onto this fish as quickly as possible, because we don't want to distress the fish, of course, because there's $16,000 worth of tags going into it, and of course, we want it to survive. So you ready, team?
Ready.
That's the main thing. Looks like Mel's taken to this quite well. No, you really have. You know, she's just lifting the fish with the rod and then winding on the downstroke. Same principle for any sort of fish. It just happens to be a marlin and very big tackle. So how does it compare to being at the bottom of a ruck being worked over?
Doesn't seem to be very different.
Very different?
Yeah, very different.
There's still a grimace on your face all the same?
Yeah, it's hard work.
No, that's it. On the home straight now. Just keep doing what you're doing. You've done well for the last 20 minutes. There it is, look at that. Look at the colour on it.
Electric blue.
Well, you've just caught yourself your first marlin, because once the... Yeah, he's got the leader, yeah. Cool. Yeah, I backed it off. I just don't wind up, don't. Just keep a little bit of slack, just behind Randall. Sorry? Okay, do you want to dive in now? Tom, away you go. Go, start rolling.
Okay, ready.
Okay. That's a nice one too. Grab him by the bottom jaw. I'll pull him just a little bit.
Turn him over.
No. Which way do we want the dorsal? We're right. Okay, where's our chamois? Staple gun. We've just put a chamois over the fish's eye down here to try and subdue it. Okay, now this is like a surgery team. Don't lose them. We've just got to try and keep the fish as calm as possible. We've got a hose that Randall's got in his mouth here, and we're pumping salt water through the fish's mouth, and that'll keep it breathing, keeping water over the mouth. Down at the other end of the fish, the guys are stapling on the pat tag.
Take that, please.
Staple gun. Suture, scalpel, suction. We need more suction. He's eating a raised bream. Okay, that's the hook out. Still got plenty of grunt in him. I can feel him. He was biting on my hand there. What do you think, Mel? How's this for a fish, eh? First time up. Well done. Congratulations. How good is this? You can see the guys here working on the tail. They've actually got a drill there. You'll see the cordless drill, and they're actually bolting the tag on. Okay, drill.
Okay.
Okay. Now that's the pat tag. Right. Now the tag we've got on the tail there is going to transmit whenever the fish is on the surface. It's going to beam information up to the satellite about where it is. And the one going in right down here now is the pop-off tag. It's a big tag. It records information about where the fish is swimming to. And when the fish, at a predetermined date, which I think is the 25th of April, that tag's going to pop off, begin transmitting information to the satellite. But right now we're just trying
2 meters 40.
Okay. So that would make about a 90 kilo fish at 2.4 meters. We just got what's called a snooter. And I'm going to try and hold him by the bill with the snooter so we can tie him.
Back.
Okay, just slowly, easy guys. Oh, there's tails caught in the. Okay. Okay, now we're just going to tie him slowly through the water. He's got plenty of life in him. But I'm just holding him by the snooter to let some air come through him. And when we see that dorsal going up and down, like he's got plenty of energy, I'm just going to slide the snooter off his bill and he's going to swim away. And all things going well, we're going to find out where he goes, about his behaviour. What a magnificent fish. Someone make the call when you want me to let him go. He's swimming. Cool? Happy? Okay, away he goes. Snooter's off. See, he's swimming under his own steam now. Slowly swimming down. All right. How good is that? How good was that? First time up, what a pro.
That was so cool.
Yeah. And of course, now that fish, once that information starts beaming out, you and I and everyone else, for that matter, we're going to know where your fish has gone, so we're going to be able to trap it on maps, and I'm sure our viewers at home will be interested as well. We'll have some sort of graphic fly up very shortly, and we're going to just track the movements of our fish. It's always nice to let them go too, eh?
Yeah, it is.
Beautiful fish.
Oh, that was amazing. Seriously amazing.
This chart shows the location of where we tagged and released Melody's marlin, just a few miles out off the east coast of Northland. But before we check on the progress of the marlin, I spoke to Tim Sipple to find out a little bit more about the tags that we had just deployed.
Now, when we dragged our striped marlin on board, things were pretty hectic. It was full on because, of course, we wanted to dispatch the marlin as quickly as possible with the satellite tags on it. So I've got Tim here, who's one of our scientists, and he's going to give us a bit of a closer look at these satellite tags. So firstly, Tim, there's two tags. What does each one of them do?
This first tag is called a PAT tag. It stands for pop-off archival tag. What it does is it records water temperature, diving depth, and sunlight intensity information several times each minute.
Yeah.
This remains attached to the fish for a period of time that we program the tag. The tag is anchored into the fish, much like a conventional tag is anchored on a fish, using a nylon plastic dart here.
Okay, so we've got all that information from that tag, so why do we slip this other tag on the tail?
So each time the fish comes to the surface and this tag is exposed to the air, it sends a transmission to the satellite. So this is really valuable for giving us a near real-time estimate of the fish's position.
So when are we likely to hear from the marlin that we tagged today?
It usually takes a day or two for the fish to settle down and for us to get those first transmissions, so we can expect to hear back from the fish within 2 or 3 days of tagging.
Oh, excellent. I'm looking forward to finding out where our fish went. Of course, we tagged it here off the Bay of Islands, but who knows where it's going to go. And how many other marlin are you looking to tag in this program?
This whole program is designed to tag 20 marlin with a combination of these two tags.
20 marlin. And so what sort of cost is involved in tagging 20 marlin with this sort of technology?
Well, these tags are not cheap. The whole program is several hundred thousand dollars, but we're fortunate enough to get some really valuable sponsorship from the Enterprise Motor Group. They're donating the time on the fishing vessel this year, the Ultimate Lady, which is a fantastic tagging platform. And we're also getting sponsorship from the New Zealand Marine Research Foundation, which is funded through the New Zealand Big Game Fishing Council.
Excellent. And hopefully all this information is going to be able to come back and be compiled and used usefully scientifically, and hopefully striped marlin will be around for many years to come because of the work you guys are doing today.
Absolutely. The objective is to learn as much as we can about these fish and gather some really exciting new stuff.
In 2006, the Blue Water Marine Research Team tagged 15 striped marlin with satellite tags aboard the Ultimate Lady. The 15 individual marlin tagged proved to be very migratory and seemed to be on the move most of the time, travelling independently. Even fish tagged on the same day would often travel in different directions. The first and most obvious thing that these movements tell us is that the marlin survived the tagging and releasing process. Even a marlin that was accidentally released before it could be revived, and it looked to be in serious trouble, has travelled from its tagging position in the Eastern Bay of Plenty and last transmitted 600 kilometres south of Fiji. Although we had achieved our objective of putting a satellite tag into a striped marlin, we decided to make the most of the ideal conditions and continue to troll in the warm tropical current that was full of floating weed. Weed like this in warm water often equals mahi mahi. And sure enough, when we went past some weed, up came a mahi mahi.
Just as we trolled past a big weed paddy, a big bunch of kelp in the water, the mahi mahi bit. Mahi mahi are known for hanging around structure. So if ever you're trolling lures and you see a bit of flotsam or a bit of weed on the surface of the water, troll your lures past it. That's what we did, and we hooked this mahi mahi. Now if you keep him at the side of the boat, quite often all his mates come around as well.
Just as we'd planned, a school of inquisitive mahi-mahi came to the boat to see what all the commotion was about.
Brad's wound his mahi-mahi to the boat. He's got a whole family of mahi-mahi around him. So I've thrown over this nice big live bait, and we're going to see if one of his mates is going to come along and eat the live bait. Look at them, they're just sturging around the boat. They're perhaps getting a little bit weary of us now. Since when we first turned up here, everyone got a bite on the lures. Randall hooked one on his bait. We didn't catch any of them, and now they've kind of stooged away. And it could be because if you look over at the kelp paddy here, you'll see our underwater cameraman stealthing around in the water, and that could be putting them off. We've got these mahi mahi schooling around on such a beautiful day, and in New Zealand waters, that's quite a rare sight. So we've pulled out some light tackle, a few baits, a few lures, and hopefully we're going to be able to hook up on some of these magnificent fighting and extremely good tasting sport fish.
What a beautiful fish that is.
The floating kelp acts like an oasis in the desert, and it becomes home to more than just mahi mahi. To our amazement, a school of bluenose had huddled beneath the kelp. Bluenose are usually found at depths beyond 250 metres, but they obviously spend their juvenile stages on the surface. And a closer look revealed that there were all sorts of juvenile fish rafting up on the floating weed. It seemed to have its own ecosystem. Even this unusual groper had claimed the kelp bed as its home, and it seemed reluctant to leave despite being filmed at close range by our cameraman. Kingfish are an inshore fish that begin their life cycle out at sea, and juvenile kingfish are often found with mahi-mahi underneath floating objects. But it was the mahi-mahi that we were trying to catch, as not many opportunities arise in New Zealand to catch one of these spectacular sport fish that also just happens to be one of the tastiest table fish in the world. The mahi-mahi weren't interested in our baits or lures, but it was still great to see them. And besides, we already had one that we wasted no time in filleting and getting straight onto the barbecue. Let's take a look at where Mel's fish went after it was released. Using the transmitter that we attached to the tail, we were able to track the marlin for 480 kilometres, and it was interesting to see that after initially heading offshore, it turned back towards New Zealand. The last information we received 66 days after the release didn't give us a location, but it did tell us that the fish was on the surface and the water temperature was 24.5 degrees, which could suggest that it is somewhere between Tonga and Fiji.